I'm Shane Balkowitsch. I operate a natural light wet plate studio out of Bismarck, North Dakota. This October 4th, I will have been doing photography, large format photography in the historic process for a decade. So this last Friday, just yesterday, I was in studio and I made my 4,318th portrait in over 9 years. I came to wet plate photography by happenstance. I didn't even own a camera at the time. There's a documentary, there's some cards here, there's a documentary on Amazon if you guys want to see more about my story. But I saw, I just happened to be on Facebook and I just happened, this image just happened to scroll by me. And I asked the photographer what that was and he explained it was a wet plate. And then I got onto Google and I've told the story many times. I got onto Google, looked up this archaic process that nobody practices anymore. It's very difficult. And it was abandoned in 1885. And I went back to the photographer. His name was Paul DeLorenz. He's a friend of mine now. And I said, well, what is that, Paul? And he said, well, Gene, it's a wet plate. I said, well, and I got an idea about what a wet plate was. And I said, well, I would just love to do that. And then Paul said, well, do you own a camera? I said, no, I don't own a camera. I've never taken a photograph, a formal photograph before. And he had been doing said, there's no way a non-photographer would ever teach themselves the wet plate process. And he wasn't being mean, he was just being honest. And within 45 days of that conversation, I made my very first plate in my first studio. So, what you see on the wall here tonight is a culmination of my goal is to capture 1,000 Native American portraits in the historic wet plate floating process. All of the portraits are donated to the State Historical Society. Yesterday, I made my 618th Native American portrait in about 8 years. It all started, if you guys look behind you, Ernie LaPointe, the gentleman here, the great-grandson of Sitting Bull, my very dear friend. I had learned that, I was just making my first wet plates, and I had learned about, I'm a history buff, so I just learned about Orlando Scott Goff in the city of Bismarck. Capturing Sitting Bull's first portrait, not a photograph of Sitting Bull, the first ever portrait of Sitting Bull was captured in Bismarck, North Dakota in the wet plate floating process. So I found out through reading a Smithsonian Institute article that Ernie LaPointe was a great grandson of Sitting Bull. So I found him in Leeds, South Dakota. I called him. He picked up on the first ring. I explained to him about what I was doing. He knew what I was doing. I explained to him the photograph. He already knew about the photograph. And I said, I'd like to capture your photograph 135 years after your great-grandfather's. And within a week, he was in my studio. And that photograph, not this particular photograph, but this is a subsequent photograph of Ernie, but it was that photograph, Eternal Field, that got me on this Native American journey. I've been given the name Makeshift Goche by the Hidatsa elder, Kelvin Grinnell, which means shadow catcher, which is a huge honor. We had a formal ceremony in my studio where we exchanged gifts and we had food and we had to have witnesses and stuff. So, and what changed about me becoming shadow catcher was I was always dedicated to this series before that, but at that point, my dedication just like went through the roof. I just felt like this desire to not let these people down. And Native Americans, when they come into my studio now, they give me a hug and they call me their brother. And that's something I did not have before I was adopted into that tribe. So it's a huge honor. I would never want to let them down. And I'm always trying to put them in the best light possible. I'm booked out about 7 months for my Friday sessions. So just yesterday we had a family fly in from Iowa to be part of my Native American series. I had an elder drive in from Nevada as well. So it's a huge honor to continue down this path of creating images. One of the things, and one of the reasons we're here today, other than to support the Spirit Room, is one of the things, once I started making these images, is people wanted to buy prints, or they wanted to buy something from me. And then I got, I did not feel comfortable making any money from this series, so I talked to Dakota Goodhouse at United Tribes, and he said, why don't you just donate the money to the American Indian College Fund? So I've been doing that ever since then. So what we're doing here tonight is these prints. This is the first time that my formal paper prints of my work have ever been available. I've really priced them reasonably to try to entice people to support. So the profits that I get from this this exhibition will go to the American Indian College Fund. And I'm really happy about that. And I do have young Native Americans that come in and said, I got a grant, I got a loan, or I got some money from so it seems to really be a good place, and it's giving back to the people that are trusting me. There will be 1,000 portraits is my goal, and like I said, I made 618 of them as of yesterday. So volume 2 of my book just came out. Volume 1 is sold out, but volume 2 is available, and so every 250 portraits, I will do another volume. So when I'm done with 1,000 portraits of Native Americans, there will be 4 volumes if anyone's collecting all 4 books. So those books are available as well. They're $60. These prints are $250. As you can see, the little dots here, we've sold 11 of the 19 prints before we even hung them. But I don't want to, they sold so fast. The whole point is to raise money for this fund. So if there's one of these portraits that you would like for me to, you would like to support the American Indian College Fund, and you'd like to purchase it, there's an order form, fill it out, pay the money, and then in about 4 to 6 weeks, I will have, these are printed in the Netherlands, I'll have one printed for you, it'll come to my studio, I'll sign it in Boston, just like these here, and then I'll frame it for you, and then I'll just mail it to your house for your charge. So I'm trying to make it as easy as possible. And many of these prints, a majority of the prints that are already sold have gone around the world. We sold one in the United Kingdom, we sold one to Australia, we sold one to Africa, so they go all over the place. So does anyone have any questions?
I wanted to ask if, they were all beautiful, but how does one find story behind who the individual is?
Well, each one of these people has their own story. They have their own regalia. They have their own tribe. And I've been asked many times to, like, write or to document some of this information about my different sitters, and I've flat out refused, okay? What's important for me is I've got to document their name. I document their Native American name. I document their tribe. I document the date that they came into me. And as an image maker, that's my expertise. There's people that are writers, and the world does not need another Caucasian man writing about Native American culture. So I've refused to do that. So when any time in articles or whatever people say, you should be documenting. I will. I got videos and stuff of people talking and stuff, but I don't myself. I do not put anything pen to paper in regards to history or anything, any other traditions as well, because it's not my position. All I can do is I can take their portrait, and then their history and stuff can be attached to this years later or by somebody else, but it's not going to be attached by me because I'm not a writer, and I'm not going to speak for them.
Have you
then come forward and say, told you that they would like to in some way or another outside of your realm?
Oh, absolutely. They provide me family trees, and those family trees will go up with the plate. So if you had the family tree of your tribe or your family tree, and you were one of the people that have my portraits taken, I've provided many family trees or poems. I've provided different narratives. Someone may want to write about their great grandmother, and that's why they were honoring them. All that documentation all goes up to the State Historical. I just give the portrait to attach other information to later on. Yeah, the title for each one of the picture is actually their Native American name in English. Not everyone Native American. It's one of the other things is people assume that everyone has a Native American name. You're Native American. That's not true. So it's a huge formal ceremony that has to happen, and someone in your family or in your tribe has got to give that name to you. So not everyone has one, and people get them later on, and then they get a name later on, and then I give that to the Historical Society. I'm trying to document. So what's really important is if you look at some of the historic plates, and understand that these plates, these are prints, but the original plates of the Historical Society are made out of pure silver on glass, and they will absolutely be in that archive in the same condition that I gave them 1,000 years from now. So what's really important is on the back of each one of those plates, I document everything that I told you about, the date, their date of birth, their names, their tribes, their Native American names. That's all on the back, and it says, by Shane Balkowitsch, Nostalgia Glass Web Plate Studio. So when you find one of these images, or you look at one of these images 500 years from now, you turn it over and you have all the information that you need to go out and find the story that if there is a story, that it should be attached to that person's portrait.
What an incredible amount of work.
it's a lot of work. Yeah. It's been a lot of work, but I don't consider it. This is my life's work. So I do other creative photography in my studio, but my Native American studio series I consider my life's work.
So you've gotten grants then from National Endowment?
This is all me.
Oh.
Yeah, I've never taken money from anyone as an artist. This is all supported by myself. My studio does this.
That's inspiring.
It really is.
I'm very fortunate. I own Balkowitsch Enterprises. We've been an online company for 24 years in the state. I refuse to take funds from anybody else because there's artists that need the funds more than I do.
Sure. Well, it's inspiring other artists to realize that they may be able to follow in your path.
Oh, that's kind. Thank you. Any other questions?
I was wondering about the scale of the images. Are these one-to-one, or?
These are, all my works are black glass ambrotypes, so they're all on black glass, and they're all 8x10 in size. So they, Luke, the master printer, blew these up. I wanted something a little bit more substantial for you guys here. And I've never done, Luke's never done my work in 11x14 before, so I gave him the scans, and he worked with the scans and made sure everything, the tonality, and was right, trying to find. I think you guys can see there's a pretty good consistency with the tonality. He did all that work for me. And then I just wanted to do something special, and the 11x14 seemed right. And he sent me a sample print, and it was like, it's the first time I was ever happy with my work. I can do studio prints, and I do studio prints every week. I'm just never that fond of them. I'm not that good at it. Because the black glass ambrotype, there's only one of them in the world. But I just did that just to learn, because I knew that historically that negatives were very popular and that photographers made contact prints all the time. So I do contact prints, cyanotypes, bandites, I've done platinum prints. But it's just not, for me, it all ends up back at that one-off silver image on glass that can't be reproduced. And that's, I just find myself, as an artist, that's just my mentality. I'm just in love with this idea that this object exists here and can exist nowhere else. I was doing contact prints. I can make contact prints now, and then 10 years make more contact prints. Every additional contact print I make, the previous contact prints become lesser in value because there's more of them in the world. So I like this one-off idea. If you guys look at this romantically, these photographs are 10 seconds of exposure. So those of you that aren't photographers, all of these people had to hold still for 10 seconds. So if you look at this romantically, these are actually 10-second movies of every person on this wall, so they had to hold completely still. There's heartbeats there, there's shallow breaths there, there's a quick blink, and maybe there's a thought there that's coming through in that 10 seconds. What we find in the modern day, I don't have to tell you, but what we find in the modern day photography, it's so darn quick, you could argue that no part of my life is in that picture. You can't argue that with this process.
It's absolutely beautiful.
Do you have the armature and everything?
Yep, the head brace, yep. Have the head brace, so. It's an invaluable tool, right?
Yeah.
And I should say, Carrie Janosek is here with us tonight. I taught her, was 2 years ago?
Three years ago.
I taught her, she came in just as a sitter and asked to do wet plating. So she came in and I taught her. And we spent the all afternoon in her own studio here in Fargo. So if you guys want to see, if you don't have to come to Bismarck to see wet plating, she has this fabulous studio downtown. And we have Chase Manhart over there. He's just started, I taught him, and how long ago, 4 months ago?
Yeah, May.
Yeah, he came in, he did a podcast on me about the Jordan Peterson controversy, and then he just fell in love with what I had to say about the process, so then he came in and said he wanted to learn, and then I taught him, and he made 144 plates this summer at his camp or whatever he's been teaching. So there's a group of us here in North Dakota get together regularly and support each other. So it's really fun to see this revitalization of the process in modern day.
Someone asked me last week how your process compares to the one that Curtis used.
Curtis was doing dry plates. So Edward Curtis made dry plates from the early 1900s to the early 1930s, 1929 or something. He actually made 40,000 dry plates. Carrie and I could have dry plates. We had our cameras. We could take 80, 90 dry plates in a day, 100 dry plates in a day. It's not the process that we have to understand. This is where we practice is 50 years prior to him. So he, I don't want to say he had it easy, but you buy dry plates, you load them in the camera, you take your exposure, you put it away, and you could develop it, fix it, and do everything within weeks, months later. That's not the case with what we practice. We have to have a dark room there. We're pouring the chemicals. We're actually making the emulsion. We're pouring the chemicals onto the plate. So it's a little bit more of a daunting task than Edward Curtis had. But what he achieved in his Native American work was the largest, in my opinion, and in many people's opinion, the largest photographic achievement of all time. He went out to over 80 tribes in horse and buggy and captured 40,000 Native American portraits. And the man died in California with his daughter, lonely, poor, and defeated, and was never recognized in his life for the work that he did. And then 30, 40 years later, after his death, his plates were found, and he becomes the most celebrated Native American portrait. I'm getting goosebumps talking about him.
Yeah,
the most celebrated Native American portrait photographer ever. There's been some controversy around Edward Curtis where he's been criticized. For instance, there was a vest on a chief in Nevada. He took a picture of it, and then he had another chief in Washington. The same vest appears on that chief, and people chastised him for that. There's a famous photograph of two Native Americans sitting in a teepee, and he accidentally forgot their alarm clock, a wind-up alarm clock in the foreground, and Curtis removed that on the negative, and he was chastised for that. And so he was using different props and stuff, and he was making some of these different elements, and I knew about this. I've read everything about him, so I've thwarted that entire thing. I never introduced anything, so none of the garments or the regalia or the props or the bow and arrows or spears or anything that you see in any of these works I've ever introduced. They either bring it or it's not used. So I've tried to separate myself a little bit from that. But I have Native Americans walk in the studio and the first thing they show me is a print of Edward Curtis's or some kind of on their phone, and they're just so proud. This is my great-grandmother, my great-grandfather, and they're so proud of the work. If we strip the world of Edward Curtis's work, the world would be lost of very, very important information. With all of his, you know, any problem you can have with his work, we're taking this man from 100 years ago, bringing him to the present, and we're chastising for some stuff in modern day, and it's I just don't think it's right.
It isn't. It's people say it's relativity, but if you look back at other times, you really can't judge according to today.
Let's ask ourselves. He went bankrupt twice.
Mm-hmm.
Why is this man going bankrupt twice to take Native American portraits? You have to ask yourself. What you go bankrupt the first time and then what? You reinvest and you double down and go bankrupt again. Oh, this man was not doing this for money. He really thought that he was capturing a people that were disappearing. And if that's one thing that you can have associated with mine and his work, is that I'm trying to prove that they didn't disappear. And I think if Edward walked through the door this evening, he would just be elated, would he not? Like in 2022, Native Americans can drive in or fly in from Iowa yesterday and have their wet plate. You know, he would go, nobody's practicing wet plate, because, I mean, it was already forgotten by the time he was practicing photography. So he would never believe you that someone in 2022 would be naked wet plate, because they had abandoned wet plate 15 years prior to when he started. Getting a little long-winded.
Sorry. This is information that probably most of us don't know. So it's a really good thing. This is an opportunity. Yeah. What year did he die?
The 1930s.
Mm-hmm.
He was with his daughter. He moved to California. And he died knowing that he never, all of his hard work over that 30-year period was for nothing.
Mm-hmm.
He actually went through a divorce, and his wife went across the street to the studio and smashed plates, like thousands of plates. She smashed his work. And that's lost. It's lost.
Time to read a biography.
Right.
Yeah. Is there a good one?
Oh, there's, yeah. Knights of the Shadow Catcher. Knights of the Shadow Catcher. Any questions, you guys?
This has been so enlightening.
Yeah, well, it's all about raising money for the American Indian College. want to say the statistic is only, and I may be wrong here, but I think it's only 13% of Native Americans make it to college or get a college degree or get to attend that first year of college. So, you know, it's a wonderful organization, American Indian College Fund, and they're very supportive of my work. And I just try to send as many checks down there as I possibly can.
Well, thank you so much for sharing all this with us.
You're welcome.